Thank you very much. Yeah, those of you that already heard that, you're excused. Okay, so I'm going to talk about fluid responsiveness. These are my disclosures as required by the organizers, Massimo and Pulcin. And I would like to start with this article that was published in the New Yorker by Atul Gawande, who is a Harvard surgeon. And he was questioning why some ideas are slow to be adopted. And he said that the pattern of many important but stalled ideas is that they attack problems that are big, but to most people, invisible. And this is why it takes time for them to be adopted. And I would like to put to you that two problems that have been invisible to most people for a long time is that fluids are a drug, and second, that we do not really know exactly how much fluid to get to give to our patient. So this is just a paper that was published last week in Intensive Care Medicine with my colleague Daniel Reuter and Professor Daniel Chappelle from Germany, that we spoke about the dark side of fluid administration, explaining the possible detrimental effects of fluids, especially when given in excess. So this has been a topic of a lot of recent articles, that on one hand we want to prevent hypovolemia, and on the other hand we are afraid of fluid overload. And this is another one on this series, but here I bring it because you can see this curve, and that curve says that at this part the patients are responders and the danger is that they're hypovolemic. Well, this part they're not responders to fluid and the danger is that they are hypervolemic. So this looks like the well-known left ventricular function curve. So when we give fluid, we expect the stroke volume to go up, but how do we decide whether to give fluids or not? So we were always relying historically on cardiac preload parameters, static parameters like central venous pressure, like the wedge pressure. But you would realize that even if we find the perfectly measured preload parameter, take end-diastolic area on echo, and we give fluid to the patient, some patient would increase their cardiac output, some patient would, and some patient would not. So preload measurement is not enough by definition to predict the response of the patient to fluid. And for that, what we actually are looking for is the slope of the left ventricular function curve. And we determine that, as fluid responsiveness, which is the degree by which the cardiac output or the stroke volume respond to a modification of preload. So when there is no, of course, we do not want to give fluid to patients who wouldn't respond, and we certainly may consider giving fluid to patients who respond. Now, fluid responsiveness is not something in the textbook, and I bring you this example here. This is my iPhone, Okay, so this is my iPhone, and you can see here the plethysmographic waveform from a pulse oximeter that is hooked by Bluetooth to my iPhone, and I'm doing some exercise in a heat on the beach in Tel Aviv, and I'm having premature beat. So look at this premature beat. Obviously, the volume that was ejected during that beat is very small, because it is premature, so there was very little time for the heart to fill, and therefore the stroke volume is very small. But after the characteristic compensatory pause, you can see that the post-ectopic beat is huge. It is much bigger than the pre-ectopic beat, the normal beat. So this shows that when the left ventricle is being filled with more blood, then it ejects more and the stroke volume is much higher. So here is the principle of fluid responsiveness in front of your eyes. We are fluid responsive. And here I just give credit to Simon Vistisen for showing this phenomena to me for the first time. So in this excellent review by Frederick Michard, the point is that we want to be more precise in our fluid management. We want to determine whether the patient is going to respond to fluids or not. So we have the series of the dynamic parameters in mechanically ventilated patient, pulse pressure variation, stroke volume variation, plethysmographic variation index, and sometimes we need to give a fluid challenge in order to see whether the patient is responding to fluids or not. Because the sobering reality is that only 50% of our patients respond to fluids. That means that when you and I, when we give fluid to a patient, one in every two patients is not going to respond to fluid. And since, as I already said, fluid can be detrimental, that puts a lot of responsibility on us to make the right decision. And findings on physical examination are not predictive of fluid responsiveness. So here are for two examples. And you all know this a major center, a major intensive care here in Belgium. And you can see in 2005 a study in which in 60 patients were judged to be hypovolemic because of tachycardia, hypotension, oliguria, or vasoconstriction. They received a hefty amount of fluid, and only 50% responded. Even these patients that were judged by the best clinician to be hypovolemic. So this is 2005, and now we go to 2017, the same group. Now it's 41 patients breathing spontaneously again. They have suspected hypovolemia based on the same physical sign. And again, only 50% respond to fluid. Nothing has changed over all these years. So this is physiology, and this is the challenge. Now, in goal-directed therapy studies, where according to the classic UK approach, you give fluids in order to maximize the stroke volume. And this is a sub-study of the optimized trial, which is the largest randomized controlled trial on goal-directed therapy. They found that less than 30% of the fluid challenges caused an increase in stroke volume. I think it's amazing. How can you recommend such a strategy in which more than 70% of the patient, more than 70% of the patient do not, 70% of the fluid challenges do not increase the cardiac output. So I wrote some years ago that the failure of some of these goal-directed therapy studies is because they focused on maximizing the stroke volume and did not take into account fluid responsiveness. So let's go through some of the dynamic parameters that can be produced in mechanically, can be measured in mechanically ventilated patient where the mechanical breath can be considered as a stimulus to the cardiovascular system, decreasing venous return. And if the patient is fluid responsive, then there is a decrease in the stroke volume on all the surrogates of the left ventricular stroke volume. And this patient obviously is a non-responder. And then came the pulse pressure variation, which is somewhat more accurate than the systolic pressure variation. Again, based on comparing the maximal beat to the minimal beat over the respiratory cycle. And with the pulse contour continuous cardiac output, we now have the stroke volume variation that serves for the same purpose. And we talked a lot about non-invasive monitoring. So with a plethysmograph, you can measure the plethysmographic variability index. So this is the arterial waveform. This is the plethysmographic waveform. Physiologically, they are different, but the respiratory variations are very similar. So with the PVI, you can say that this patient is probably going to respond to fluid, while this patient is probably not going to respond to fluid. And of course, the plethysmograph has limitations. It's a softer signal. And in this article by Xavier Monet and Louis Thiboul, they showed that it doesn't work so well in the ICU when patients receive adrenaline. So this is something that is probably more for the operating room. Now, we have to realize, as I said before, that more than 50% of patients in which fluid loading is considered clinically indicated are non-responders. But, sorry, that was wrong slide. I just shortened my presentation from previous. But the point I'm trying to make is the following. If you use dynamic parameters to guide your fluid management, you may end up with giving the patient less fluids than the control group, which is exactly the opposite than if you try to maximize stroke volume. So here is one of the papers, one of the studies that show that, and they incorporated a PVI-based protocol in an enhanced recovery protocol, and they showed that it led to a substantial reduction in length of stay, complication, and cost. But look at that. They did not give fluids to patients that had the plethysmographic variability index of more than 13. And just by doing that, they decreased the amount of fluid that was given to the patient from 2.7 liters to less than a liter. So this is very substantial, and not just the PVI, of course. Here is a paper where they used the stroke volume variation, and again, they showed that if you use stroke volume variation protocol, you give less fluid. So this is the major advantage of using dynamic parameters, that you can identify non-responder and not give them fluid. And this is why you can end up giving less fluid to patients that actually do not need it. And together with my friends from the Charité in Berlin, we wrote that dynamic parameters should be used to guide fluid therapy in surgical patients, all surgical patients, in whom their use is appropriate. And we'll see what do I mean by that, as part or not of a goal-directed therapy study. It's not enough to say, I use dynamic parameters. Here is a study, a very bad study coming from the UK, in which they used a stroke volume variation of 10 as a cutoff, and they ended up giving a liter more to the patient that in the intervention group. And the reason is that stroke volume variation of 10 is not a good cutoff. It's just in the middle of what is called the gray zone. So it really doesn't tell you if the patient is a responder or a non-responder. When we use dynamic parameters, we always have to think about the stimulus, because dynamic parameters are being produced out of a process in which you have a standardized stimulus that challenges the cardiovascular system by modifying preload, and then you have a response that should be readily measured and interpreted. That's quite a complex process, and this is why there are many confounding factors that may decrease the usability of this approach. And here we have quite a number of limitations and confounding factors that anyone who is relying on dynamic parameters has to know exactly and exclude them, and to know that they will be less accurate in spontaneous breathing, non-sinus rhythm, when tidal volume is too high or too low, et cetera, et cetera. Presence of right heart failure, for example. I don't have time to go over all that list. So when we cannot use dynamic parameters, because for the patient is not mechanically ventilated, then we have to use a fluid jam. But a lot of us just give fluids and look at the blood pressure, and that is not the way to go, especially if the risk of making a mistake is really substantial. If the patient has a history of congestive heart failures and pulmonary edema, and therefore you need a continuous cardiac output monitor to see whether the patient responds to a fluid bolus or not. And the same, again, from Xavier Monet and Jean-Louis Teboul, the passive leg raising test, you look at the old literature, it's kind of inconclusive. Why? Because they measure cardiac output with a PA catheter. But here, in order to see whether a PLR is identifying fluid responsiveness, you need to use a continuous cardiac output as well. So the recommendation to use dynamic over static variable was accepted by this consensus on circulatory shock of European Society of Intensive Care Medicine. And in the new surviving sepsis campaign guideline, they're introduced as well, for the first time, dynamic parameters like pulse pressure variation, like the response to a fluid bolus, or like fluid, or like passive leg raising. What they don't say is measure cardiac output. That's my strong belief, that every patient with suspected septic shock, we need to measure his cardiac output, both for assessment of fluid responsiveness and both to see what are the result of the various therapies that we administer. This is a good example of an algorithm. This is expert opinion on management of hemodynamic in ARDS patients with Jean-Louis Taboul. And you can see here, this originally was pulse pressure variation, but I put here any significant dynamic parameter. So if there is no fluid responsiveness, then you don't give fluid. You consider norepinephrine. If there is dynamic parameters that show values that show fluid responsiveness, you have to exclude right ventricular overload and many other of the limitations that I have mentioned already. And then you have to discuss whether to give fluids or not, because the presence of fluid responsiveness is not an absolute indication to give fluid. The final decision has to take into account the perceived benefits and the associated risk. In conclusion, assessment of fluid responsiveness is a crucial continuous dynamic parameter in mechanically ventilated patients are very good indicators of fluid responsiveness, but their limitation should be well recognized. Intermittent preload modifying maneuver like a fluid challenge or passive leg raising are useful when combined with a continuous measurement of cardiac output. But even in fluid responsive patients, decision regarding fluid measurement should always take into account the risk-benefit ratio. And I thank you for your attention.